Hi, this is Mark Storacci of Crocus, and I hope you enjoy the rockumentary about Crocus, which you're about to hear.
Alright, it's time for another edition of Metal Express Radio's Rockumentary Series, and we're honored to have Mark Storacci as our guest, and this will be all about Crocus. Mark, how are you doing these days?
I'm fine, thank you, and even feeling better now that we're back here with in Scandinavia with Hammerfall and the Poodles, and the reaction from the fans is great, so I couldn't feel better.
Let's go way back. Your first album with Crocus was Metal Rendezvous.
Yes.
How come you joined the band before this album?
Well, I knew the band before because when I was singer in T, that was the first professional band I joined, and we recorded three albums with Dieter Dierks and toured with Queen and so on and so forth. We were pioneers and opened doors for bands like Crocus, actually. And they supported us on our last tour before we split, you know. And so I got to know them then. And when I returned to London, because that was the original place where I started out from after leaving my original birthplace in Malta, in the Mediterranean. then I formed my own band called Easy Money, and just before signing a deal with Chrysalis, some other things started happening, like an audition with Rainbow and meeting Blackmore and Cozy Powell and Roger Glover and, you know, Don Airey, and like being with the real, you know, bigger stars, you know. And I mean, I had never been to the USA at that point, you know. Then when I returned home to London, I got this phone call from Crocus, you know, saying, "Remember us, you know, of course I remember you, how you doing, blah, blah, blah," and singer problems. And, you know, since with Easy Money, I was kind of slightly insecure about the internal thing within the band, you know, there was already some intrigue, and I really didn't feel this was gonna last, you know. And before signing any deals and everything, that's why I accepted to audition with Rainbow. And then when Crocus rang up, I said, well, T was from Switzerland, I had spent 6 years there, so it just sounded very inviting to get back there, you know, eat some fondue and jam out some rock and roll with Swiss musicians again, you know. And of course, I was really a big fan of their guitar player, Tommy Kiefer, who unfortunately had to leave the band due to his drug problems later on, you know. And so that's how I got to Crocus. Basically, it was destiny.
Metal Rendezvous is a very good album, and it did well, triple platinum in Switzerland. You didn't contribute any writing on this album. Was the songs done before you joined the band?
Well, most of the material was done already when I joined, but of course I contributed my, you know, for example, first thing I did was I corrected some Swiss English into English, and I even messed around with some of the lyrics and added a whole lot more in certain parts, and you know, came up with lots of other ideas, backing vocals and so on and so forth. But I'm not, how can I say, there's nothing there to show that on the back of the album when you read the credits. I was not credited for that, but anyway, it was the first one. And but basically the songs were finished, the whole the backbone, the skeleton and the meat was there, and I added a lot of you know, corrections and details and melody lines and so on and so forth. Yeah.
Some of your greatest classics are on this album. How do you look upon the album now, your debut with Crocus, when you look back?
Well, it was a milestone, a very important album for me. And as I said, I took a big risk. You know, it was like saying bye-bye to my own band members in London. And, you know, that was the end of Easy Money. And so I was very serious about it. And even when I talked to the band, I said, I'll do a one-year contract with you, and if it doesn't work out after 1 year, you know, I want to be free to, you know, go if I want to. But it ended up for 8 whole years, 7 studio albums, 1 live album, and touring up to 9 months a year. Last night when I was lying in my
before, you released one album every year for the first years in your career with Crocus. And your second album with the band came in 81, Hardware. Was that an easy album to make after the quite big success with your first album with the band?
In that time, I got more integrated into Crocus, and during the writing period, I flew over and did a couple of weeks writing with the band, and contributed my first whole lyric to the band, because, you know, there was some competition within the band members, and so my first lyric was Burning Bones of War, and it was a song which I was inspired to write a protest song against war, and this was due to the Russian invasion of Afghanistan in 1980, I guess, yeah. And so, you know, I continued contributing wherever I could, and it was actually more fun doing Hardware, because I was, you know, I was in Switzerland working on the demos together with the band.
And then you went to London to record your next albums. Mm-hmm. Why did you do that?
Well, I mean, I lived in London. London was like the mecca of the new wave of heavy metal. It started out there, and there were all these journalists there, and the whole scene, you know. I mean, we just wanted to get out of Switzerland, you know. We wanted to eat Indian food and have Chinese takeaways, and you can't afford that in Switzerland even today. It's a speciality, and it's the same like with tennis, you know. Playing tennis, you have to join an expensive club and stuff, and all, it's all bullshit. I mean, in the USA, we learned that tennis is a game of the people, and it's a game of sport to keep you healthy, and that's it. It's got no snobbery around it, you know. Yeah, and you know, it's the same with, for example, Indian and Chinese food. You know, it's like people are kind of, they think only the elite, you know, can pay that, you know. So anyway, we wanted to just get out in the closest place for us, which we were familiar with, and everybody could speak English in the band. And I lived in London anyway. I had my flat there, and so it was a good place to start to record. Inspiring, you know. During the time you're not in the studio, you can walk around and take in inspiration, you know.
So you had a few classics on this album as well. Do you think that Hardware was a worthy follow-up album to Metal Rendezvous?
Well, Hardware became more metal than Metal Rendezvous.
Yes.
but the Metal Rendezvous title had actually, you know, it was a great title, great cover. And also combining with the new wave of heavy metal and blah blah blah. Hardware was just more crunchy, more balls to the wall, you know. Mm. Just like the title, Hard, harder than Metal Rendezvous.
He was standing at the big low deal.
And in 82 you released One Vice at a Time, and then you took a step even further. I mean, you played in the States for the first time and you got a new record deal, right?
Yeah, yeah. We already played in 81 actually in the States, because that's when Mandy Meyer replaced Tommy Kiefer on lead guitar, and the Hardware tour went from 81 into 82 and included the USA with Mandy, and we were already signed to Butch Stone when we met him, even before we went into the studio to do this Hardware. And One Vice at a Time came, was like a continuation of this whole thing, except that we had Mark Kohler replacing Mandy, you know, because Mandy unfortunately should have been on this album, but then wasn't, because, yeah, I mean, Mandy was born to play lead guitar, and, you know, he was asked to play rhythm guitar, you know, and you can't do that, you know, because Fernando wanted to play lead, you know. But when Tommy played lead guitar, Fernando was rhythm guitarist, you know, so it's kind of, he just wanted to climb higher, you know, and he worked hard on it and he became good at it, but also he has his limits, you know, always did.
Well, looking at the track list, what are your favorite tracks of this album, One Vice?
Long Stick is a song which we play nearly in every live concert because it's so bombastic, you know, it's so heavy, and it's good to have one of these songs in the set. It's like pillars, you know, which hold up a roof, you know.
And I guess your audience expect you to play that?
To play that, yeah. Yeah. Tonight, Long Stick goes boom. Then we have the fast ones, Bad Boys, Ragdolls, we've had in the headlining set on the last tour we did. Playing the Outlaw, we haven't played for a long time, To the Top, Down the Drain. American Woman is always in the set as well when we headline.
We'll be right back. You have recorded a lot of songs during your career. When you look through the track list, are there a lot of songs that you don't have time to play, that you kind of miss to play and would like to play, but you don't have time?
Yeah, in German you say we have the Qual der Wahl, you know, the pain of the choice, because we would like to play much, much more. And our dream is to, well, now we're fighting to get back to where we should really be. You know, we want to be headliners again, like we were in the 80s. And hopefully, if we even get bigger than that, you know, we can play two nights in every city and play two different set lists. Actually, we need to play three nights to be able to play everything. But, you know, it's that's a dream, you know.
Sure. The year after, in 83, you released, well, one of the milestones, Headhunter, one of my favorites, and I know a lot of people like this album. It went platinum in the USA.
Yeah, it went platinum. It put the band up there with the big ones, number 24 on the Billboard charts of the USA. And we did the biggest tour we ever did with Def Leppard as special guests. We had the same agent, and they were at number two after Michael Jackson with his album Beat It. And it was a great time to be in the USA. It was a fantastic time, you know. Like, we drove around city streets at night, and the young people were out driving, listening to Michael Jackson, and other cars would drive by listening to Def Leppard, others were listening to Crocus, like all this, like, big commotion, you know, happening around the city. They're all going into the burger joints, you know, parking lots, and really amazing. And we were filling auditoriums like from 10,000 to 25,000 seaters every night, with days off in between. And I used to stay up jamming in hotel bars sometimes till the early hours with Phil Collin of Def Leppard. And that was a really great tour, actually, the Headhunter tour for us. And our fans came, and they were in there with Def Leppard fans, and there was a high level of females too. It was nice, all the nice pretty girls out there, and like never before, more than on an AC/DC tour or a Judas Priest tour, you know, because of the type of songs that Def Leppard did.
Rob Halford actually did some backing vocals for this album.
Yeah, because we used their producer, you know, we used Tom Allen, and Tom was a great inspiration. He was like a father figure who didn't say too much, and he just let us go, you know, and just pushed us along with his good spirit, you know, and made us really confident, you know, the nerves. Every band is so nervous when they go into a studio. It's incredible. And our main goal was always to try and bring the energy that we bring in a live concert onto vinyl, you know, in those days, to try and catch it on vinyl. And that's very difficult, you know. You have to do it with your spirit, and no electronics can do that. And I think we managed to do it, and we had a nice collection of songs there, which were like more on the metal, leaning to the metal side, than if you compare to Metal Rendezvous again, you know. And we have always the most songs on the set list today are still from this album. We play, for example, today, Headhunter, Eat the Rich, Screaming in the Night, and we talked about Russian Winter last night, but we only talked about it.
Maybe later. There was another change in the lineup for this album. Freddie Steady was replaced by Steve Pace on drums. Have all the changes in the lineups been a big problem for the band, or has it sometimes been good to have some fresh blood coming in?
Well, yes and no. I mean, fresh blood is always good, but I mean, it's really the last card, you know, to change for me. And I always fight not to change. I always fought against that, and I was the yang in the and in the yin yang situation, you know, if you like. Freddie was always great as a showman as well, as a person, and you know, great drummer. And I was sad to see him leave, but Steve Pace was another great person, you know. And new blood, but he had a hard time too getting on in this team, if you like. But he did a great job, and I mean, it's great to listen to Headhunter today, you know, still. And of course, you know, Stefan, say no more. We'll be right back.
Let's move to 1984 and the Blitz. Here you took a different direction. What happened on this album?
I would basically say we had been in the States too long on the road, in studios, and we started to suddenly lose a little objectivity. And you know, I mean, you can't, how can I say, yeah, suddenly the record company and our agent wanted to have a clean Harley Davidson instead of a, you know, a muddy one, if you like, you know. And I mean, we were a rough and tough road gang, and they wanted to make like more attractive, like to be more attractive to the girls, because and this all came from watching us with on tour with Def Leppard and seeing their sales figures and our sales figures and the possibility of being able to reach that. I could see the logic behind it, but it's very dangerous to do that. You lose your hardcore base, you know, your fan base. So anyway, I mean, you know, there was money around, big production, blah blah blah, but the spirit was getting weaker, you know. And our resistance against these kind of a push from the left, push from the right, you know. And Chris was no longer in the band then, and we changed band members again. Jeff Clavin, another good drummer, but also an American guy, different than Steve Pace, who was also an American drummer. Like, Steve Pace was more into denim and leather, you know, and Jeff was more into like hairspray and whatever. So the glam area came, and we just slid into this whole glam thing, and I don't think that was good for us. But you know, I was there too, and it sucked me in as well, so I guess we learn from our mistakes, and if we get a second chance, we shouldn't do them again, you know.
The album was actually produced by Bruce Fairbairn and recorded by Bob Rock, so big names.
Yeah, and big expectancies by us, you know. I mean, we thought, wow, you know. He did Loverboy, you know. you know, really nice, sophisticated rock songs, you know, which sounded great, and, you know, drive the car and listen to Loverboy, and they had the girls, they had the students, you know, so it was okay with, you know, we parted with those guys and everything, and yeah, Bryan Adams, so even Bryan Adams was still quite a gritty commercial singer, you know. Yeah. And Bob Rock, of course, you know, very into metal and stuff like that. So we really expected better results, you know. But
whose idea was it to cover Ballroom Blitz on this album?
The record company came up with that idea. I think it was Clive Davis, you know, who said, yeah. And you know, I mean, they put their money where their mouth was too, you know. It's like, let's do this, let that. And it was like, bang, you know, on the table. And it's like, wow, they're really going to make us big. And you know what I mean? They're going to go for it and stuff. And yeah, it's, I mean, a nice big ballad like Our Love Will Never Die, nice videos, a big live video we did close to New York with whole production. Really expensive shit, you know, with fireworks and everything. And yeah, but I mean, I know what was wrong. We went through that, and now it's passé, you know. Sure. It's the past. But
after this, it took for the first time 2 years before your next album.
Mm-hmm.
Change of Address, not exactly your best album, that either.
Not our best album, but I wouldn't say that the songs are all that bad. You know, there are good songs on this album. And what happened here is our record company wanted us to go a step further in the wrong direction for us, you know, further away from Headhunter, you know. And that's when trouble started, you know, because we had a really big fight about who was going to produce it, because we said, we want to produce this one. And they said, no, you know, like, we don't trust you. But somewhere there are demos of these songs, and if you listen to them, you hear that we made a step back to Headhunter with the production of these songs. So when the album was finished, I mean, I for one was really unhappy with the results, because they just didn't sound, they sounded too like, I mean, Say Goodbye sounds like a gospel band, you know. it's a great song, and a lot of fans ask to, you know, why we don't play songs from this, some songs, but I think that was another thing of the times. We worked with the Tom Werman.
Yep.
And he was a great engineer in the studios in Hollywood. We were even in Hollywood. I mean, you know, give me a break, you know. How more plastic can you get, you know? I'd rather be, you know, to make an album, I'd rather be in some rainy old city where you enjoy being in a studio, because there's no sunshine out there, and when you go out, you can see some, you know, realities of life, you know, from the social status and work, you know, and that's what Crocus is all about, you know. I mean, some of the social comments, of course it's an entertainment, but you have to write lyrics about something, and you can't, you know, preach bullshit, you know. The kids out there, especially in this day and age, you know, and this was lyrically also a good one, I think, you know.
Whose idea was it to cover Schools Out, another cover track?
Well, we wanted to call the album Change of Address, which was really saying we were gonna go more commercial with that, you know. So for that, there's a picture of a school which is being blown up, and so the idea came to do Schools Out by Alice Cooper, because I mean, he does good music too, and it was something rebellious. It was a hit. It kind of suits Crocus, and suited that album, so we did it. But my favorite cover to this day is still American Woman.
Yeah.
And that was written by Canadians. It was an anti-Vietnam protest song, and it was really great. And also musically, because we could really put our personality into someone else's idea, you know, not just like Schools Out is more one-on-one copy, you know.
Everybody get up.
the same year you released the Alive and Screaming album, album. Any particular reason for making such an album?
Well, we wanted to catch the crowds, you know, our crowds. Actually, the idea was, you know, to get the Dallas, the biggest audience we ever played for.
Texas Jam.
Yeah. And it was also good that we did this, you know, because we have a memory of that. And then we actually, that was the last thing we did with Arista, you know. Mm. And they did this album cover without even checking with us, because communication was so bad. Nobody would call each other, and they used this. And Fernando got really pissed off. He said, they did this just to make me mad because he resembles me. give me a break, Fern.
Do you sometimes go back and listen through your old albums?
Mm. On vinyl, yeah. I have a record player at home, and the old speakers, and put them on, and you know, they blast away with more power on vinyl, and there's more deep end, you know. It's I need to have that deep end.
Show it, it's all you got.
Well, in 1988 you released Heart Attack. That was the last album before you left the band. It's a good album. You signed with MCA for this. What happened in this period?
Yeah, well, I mean, actually, after the change of address tour, we should have packed our bags and said, let's let it be and wait for better times. But instead, you know, there were, you know, our management and a couple of other guys in the band wanted to fight on. And yeah, it was, Chris came back and we armed ourselves with the old spirit, but it wasn't a natural thing really, and it was really like David against Goliath, you know, with this grunge scene coming, and we didn't do so well with that album because of those reasons anyway, so it was too late to patch up the mistakes we did with the Blitz and with Change of Address. It should have come right after Headhunter, you know, and then things would have been better.
The band actually kept it going. They released Stampede in 1990. Did you check out that album when it was released?
Yeah, I gave it two listens and that was it. And I thought, well, musically not bad. Singer, melodies, songs, not so good. I mean, it was a new band, new attitude. It was like Phil Collins with Brand X instead of with Genesis, you know. This kind of
then it took 5 more years, and then you reunited for To Rock or Not To Be. And, well, that's another good album.
That's a good album. We did that album again in a time when hard rock was less in demand. And in Switzerland, though, we had our loyal fan following, and we could do a healthy tour, you know, sold out about 10 gigs. And then we checked the over the borders, you know, if we could possibly tour Europe. And it was so tight, you know, we would have had to do it in such a tight way that nobody was really interested anymore to go that low, you know. The energy wasn't really here, and there was nothing really big happening around the rest of Europe. I mean, if we did that then, we would have been the first revival, if you like, you know. And the reason why we did that album, really, because it was a reunion of the old band with Freddie Steady back in the band, Mark Kohler, who had never left since he joined in for the One Vice at a Time album, and Fernando and myself, and we had a new bass player. And the reason why, how it came about, it reminds me of a time when Fernando and I met after, it was the first time we met since Heart Attack. And Fernando had just been going through his period of cancer. And when we met, we buried the hatchet, you know, about any past differences, and I invited him home. He met my wife and our newborn child, and, you know, even held him and gave him the bottle, you know. And then I suggested, you know, hey, how about Crocus, you know, it would do you good for your spirit and everything, get your mind thinking on other things, kind of in a healing way, you know. To Rock or Not To Be, that was something really good, actually, very good. Lion Heart, and The Night Away, what's it called, that song? Flying Through the Night Away. Yeah, here it is. And Natural Blonde. Yeah, that was kind of a good album. Good album to do. And we did a great tour, which I'll never forget. And then we all went our ways again.
Did you split, or was it like nothing happened? And
nothing happened. We never said bye-bye. We just said, okay, till the next time. And nobody knew what was going to be next. And there was no driving force, like a strong manager who could fix the financial side and get a good thing going again. You know, like call them, all the musicians, put positive energy into it and get the team back together and moving forward. You know, musicians alone, it's difficult, you know. You always need a driving force. And we had our ex-sound engineer being the manager. And we, you know what I mean? Mm. But that's not enough. He's too close to the band. There has to be a certain distance and respect, you know, mutual respect, and then it works. And of course, somebody who knows how to fill in the pockets to be able to at least function, you know.
Come friends! rock is still alive. You get together with your best friends on a magical drive. Crank up the sound, turn it out loud, shout out your feelings out. Fasten your seatbelt, light up the smoke. One way up, we go. And we're flying through the night away, far, far away. And we'll find a place we'd like to stay, far, far away. And we're flying through the night away, at the speed of light. And we'll find a place we'd love to stay. You gotta hold on
again. It was released another Crocus album without you in 1999, is that right? Round 13?
Yeah, that was nearly the death of Crocus. I mean, it went down with every album since Change of Address. Record sales went down with Heart Attack, then Stampede. To Rock or Not to Be was healthy in Switzerland, and nearly went gold, just maybe 1,000 records from gold. It should be gold now, actually. I must check with the old company. And then round 13, my God, oh my God. And I really felt bad for my old baby, you know. I thought, oh no, how can I live with that, you know, seeing the band I once put my heart and soul into now being like the carpet on the floor, you know, everybody walking over it, you know.
Did they ever ask you to participate on that album?
Oh, no. Fernando tried to find people that would tour for peanuts, you know, tour and go on tour for a beer. I mean, come on, give me a break. You know, it's a job as well, you know, being in a band, it's a job. You have bills to pay at home when you're on tour. So anyway, but at that time I was doing a lot of work in Switzerland on my own, and, you know, also when I left Crocus before Stampede was released, you know, I got married, I had my children, my house, and was settled in since a long time, you know, after being so many years on the road. And yeah, there's always so much to say. I was preparing to do another solo album because we were in the 90s, and I thought, yeah, I'm going to do again a wide spectrum of my personal choices, yeah. And I wanted to find a deal and go shopping, and I already checked out in the internet that there was a couple of bands reuniting and having successful tours in the States, you know, like Whitesnake and Deep Purple Never Stopped, and Scorpions, Dio, I think. And I thought, wow, it's really happening, you know. So instead of shopping for my solo thing, I thought it would be wiser to give Fernando a call, because now we could definitely find a management and everything and get the whole thing on its feet and be able to finance the revival of Crocus, you know, have a comeback. And it took him a while to answer. He called me after I went. I was invited as special guest with this big Swiss troubadour, you know, who sang in Swiss German. And he sold out the biggest hall in Switzerland two nights. We sold it out once. Wow. And there was another guy, DJ Bobo, who sold it out once after us. And Gölle, you call him Gölle, G-E-L-L-E. invited me and DJ Bobo because we were the other Swiss acts that sold out this temple of rock, if you like, the Hallenstadion. And so it was a televised thing, and I sang Bedside Radio. We rehearsed that and made it longer, so I had a long sing-along in the middle, and the whole stadium sang, and this was televised live, and Fernando checked that out, you know. So a couple, 2 days later, I was hi, regarding the reunion, I think you must be right. So, well, I think you had some coffee today. So anyway, we got together and then, hey, voila, rock the block. Yes.
Rock the block.
Yes.
Everyone is looking to America. A global village in a high-tech age.
So you must be happy you did this after this album was released in 2003. Yeah, yeah. You went straight to number one.
Straight to number one, and I was like, wow, the Lazarus rises, you know. the phoenix strikes again, you know. So it was really satisfying, and it filled me full of energy, and it hasn't left me since then. Things really have been happening since Rock the Block. We toured Europe extensively again. We came to Sweden for the first time, did a huge festival, Sweden Rock. We've been breaking territories we've never even been. Even in our own country, we played Montreux Festival for the first time. And we did a DVD, which was released later on Fire and Gasoline. So during this tour, we even recorded a lot of live sets, and with the intention of making a double live album to be even better than Alive and Screaming. And we managed to do that. It sounds much better than Alive and Screaming. And I even suggest, if you want to buy a Crocus live album, then it has to be Fire and Gasoline.
Last year, you released Hellraiser, one of my Crocus favorites, actually. It's a very good album. But this time, you were alone. Fernando left the band. You were kind of the backbone of the band, the two of you together. Yeah. Did you ever doubt if you should continue without him this time?
No, I didn't doubt. I would have started to doubt if I couldn't find the right guitar player. But luckily Mandy was standing by. I knew he loved the band, because he came to a couple of concerts and we talked and party. We always party when we meet for years, you know, since the Hardware days. So first choice, obviously, is a good friend, good guitar player. He was born to play guitar. And he was at that point really frustrated, because he wasn't playing since he had left Gotthard maybe a year earlier. And I thought, well, he's working on a solo album, but he could be with his old band again. So I had a good feeling about it. So when Fernando had been actually blocking the way, you know, he had his cancer in the mid 90s. He overcame that, thank God. And then it started with his finger. He said a nerve which goes all the way up to the shoulder each time he presses the strings, and to me he started to look to sound a little bit confused, and I didn't know where it was coming from, you know, because I thought, why the hell isn't he feeling as happy as me? Because, you know, the band is happening with Rock the Block, and we have, you know, the world is really open again. It's up to us, you know, to put the energy in it. And it seems to me he didn't want to put this energy, or maybe he didn't have this energy. It's very, very difficult to know really what's going on in Fernando's mind. It's always been that way. And we managed to keep a good relationship by not trying to get too close, you know. It's like a marriage, you know. Sometimes it's better when you're away working instead of being at home all the time, you know. Sure. And when he actually refused to do two American tours, you know, I thought, hell, you know, it was really bad. And we went into pre-production for Hellraiser already at the end of 2004. And when Mandy joined 2005, I wrote some songs with him, because he had loads of ideas. And then we went straight on tour to the USA, back, you know. Not the best, not the strongholds, but the toughest part, the East Coast. It was always the toughest area for us. And we went right there and did 22 gigs in 30 days. And through this, we found out that we needed a new drummer, you know, who really couldn't take the pressure, the pace, and didn't have the stamina to carry it on. I mean, unfortunately. And then we didn't want to do any more mistakes, and we took Stefan, and we already had the songs. We had Dennis Ward, who had already produced the single Hellraiser, and we did this as a pre-test with him, because we had to deliver one single, and Hellraiser was chosen already in its demo form out of 15 other songs, and it was for this comedy film called Handyman, and we have this song Hellraiser, the single, on there, on the soundtrack. And the soundtrack went to number one in Switzerland on the soundtrack charts. So it was already exposed before we were finished with the album. So we decided to call the album Hellraiser because of the logical association, you know. And it, the good thing about this also was that it allowed us to try out, see how it works with Dennis Ward as a producer.
Yep.
And after that we said, yeah, it's got to be Dennis, and we'll even start in the same studio he chose in Winterbach. It's an old school studio with modern stuff in there, and we all really enjoyed doing it, you know.